Marguerite Alibert was born in Paris in the year of 1890. Her father was a taxi carriage driver, but she embellished on this in later years by claiming he was a solicitor's clerk. From an early age, she had violent screaming fits, which were uncontrollable. She also displayed a penchant for dressing in boys' clothes, which she much preferred to her dresses. By the age of 9, her parents could no longer control her and decided to place her in a nunnery. The nuns eventually placed her in the service of a rich family who threw her out when at the age of 15 she had fallen pregnant to an unknown man. A girl was the result of this liaison, whom she named Raymond. This child she placed into care on a farm in central France. Marguerite rarely saw her daughter in the first 7 years of her childhood. After being cast out onto the street, Marguerite drifted into prostitution in Paris. Being bright and attractive, she soon attracted the attention of a brothel madame, who ran a very high-class establishment catering to the desires of high society gentlemen. It was in this pleasure establishment that Marguerite was taught how a lady should act in polite society. She was taught dinner table etiquette and to be able to converse on topical matters, etc. And so, under this madame's wing, Marguerite metamorphosed from a street prostitute into a fine-mannered courtesan. Outside in society, Marguerite was to be every inch a smart and demure lady. But inside four walls with her high-paying clients, she must be an adventurous and willing participant in all manner of sexual predilections. Whether it be dressing up and role-playing, sadomasochism games, or girl-on-girl, this particular brothel was renowned for catering to bisexuals. Marguerite became proficient in all forms of sensual pleasure. Marguerite soon began to realize that she had a great sexual allure, and that wealthy men were more than willing to shower her with expensive gifts and to have her as their keep, which in those days meant a kept woman. She loved the luxuries these men provided for her, but she wanted more. She wanted to elevate herself far above her humble beginnings. She wanted status as well as riches. In 1907, aged 17, she met André Mellor, the rich 40-year-old son of a Bordeaux wine merchant. He had a stable of horses, which was her passion, and he bought her an apartment where they could enjoy their trysts in private. She took his name and became Madame Mellor, claiming they had got married, but in truth André was already married and was unable to get his marriage annulled. The couple parted company in 1913 because Marguerite couldn't stay faithful to just one lover, for she realized that by having many rich benefactors at the same time meant increased wealth for her and to fund a lifestyle that she was quickly becoming accustomed to. Her lovers would shower her with expensive gifts, and most of these gifts she would return to the shop for a refund, or else to a pawnbroker's establishment to sell. Her savings accumulated. In the next few years, Marguerite started to meet many influential people, but it was a meeting in 1917 that really brought her close to the world she so craved to be a part of. A distinguished friend of hers introduced her to the sexually naive Prince Edward VIII. The meeting was arranged at the Hôtel de Crillon. Edward, 23, was serving with the army in France. He had recently lost his virginity to a courtesan borrowed from a fellow officer, but it was decided he needed a full education from an experienced woman. Marguerite was thought perfect for this role. She was a few years older than him and known to be discreet. During the formal introduction, the prince asked Marguerite if she'd like to come for a drive in his new Rolls-Royce. The drive in Edward's car led very quickly to Marguerite's apartment. Although only a few years older than him, she was years ahead in boudoir experience. This was her world, and she was in full control. Edward was spellbound by this hypnotic temptress. She introduced him to delights and awakened in him desires that were up until then still dormant. She was excellent in catering to the exact needs of her men and women. She was also a dominatrix by nature. Edward became totally besotted by Marguerite. When he had to be away from Paris, they exchanged many love letters full of affection and erotic meanderings, and he also included many photos of himself. These letters were very indiscreet, and Marguerite not only delighted in them, but kept every single one of them. By 1918, Edward's passion for Marguerite had cooled. The reason for this is not known. Some theorize he feared the backlash if his dalliance with her became public. Marguerite wrote only a discreet mention of the parting in her diary. Peace arrived, and that put an end to everything. Edward also started an affair early that same year with the wife of an English MP. This is for me the probable reason for him breaking contact with Marguerite. Marguerite soon realized that the affair was ended, and in November, Edward had confided in his attaché that Marguerite had let it be known to him that she still had the love letters. The wording had overtones of blackmail. By December, she had ceased writing to him, and it can only be a matter of speculation why. Was a sum of money paid? Or was she warned off by English agents? Edward breathed a sigh of relief for the time being. Marguerite continued with her menagerie of lovers, and this time really married one. His name was Charles Laurent, and he was an heir to a retail fortune. Within 6 months, she had divorced Laurent, and the settlement was generous. Marguerite received a lifetime allowance and he paid the rent for a magnificent apartment in the heart of Paris. Marguerite was a shrewd businesswoman, and to her, collecting and captivating wealthy men was exactly that, a business. She had worked hard at bettering herself, and it was paying dividends. In 1922, she met another extremely wealthy man in a Paris hotel. This meeting would be a life-changing chapter in her life. The man she met was a 22-year-old Egyptian who had been given the title of Prince by the King of Egypt. Shortly after meeting Marguerite, the infatuated Ali proposed marriage to her. Marguerite, beside herself with joy, accepted. She had to convert to Islam, otherwise Ali would be disinherited for marrying a non-Muslim. In early 1923, they sailed down the Nile on Ali's luxurious yacht. Their honeymoon was a visit to Lord Carnarvon's dig at the tomb of Tutankhamun. The arguments began very shortly after the marriage. Ali expected a submissive wife, and Marguerite was far from that. She started writing down a list of complaints against Ali, which she sent to her lawyer in Cairo, accusing Ali of keeping her prisoner on his yacht and of physically and sexually abusing her. It appeared to many that she was preparing for an expensive divorce settlement. Shortly after this, Marguerite started carrying a handgun and slept with it under her pillow at night. In July 1923, the couple travelled to London, staying at the Savoy Hotel. There she summoned the house doctor and complained about hemorrhoids, saying they were caused by her husband, who had torn her by unnatural sexual intercourse. She asked the doctor to provide a certificate attesting to her injuries, which he politely refused to do. Ali tried to reconcile with Marguerite, but she rebuffed him and informed him of her intention to return to Paris. On the evening of July the 9th, the couple went to the theatre to watch The Merry Widow at Daly's Theatre. After, they returned for a late supper at the Savoy, where they had a violent argument. Marguerite threatened to smash a wine bottle over Ali's head, and he replied he'd do the same to her. After this, Ali ventured out again, alone and in full evening dress, apparently in search of adventure. At around 2 a.m., he returned to the hotel. A night porter saw him in the hallway near his suite whistling for Marguerite's little dog. Only some few seconds later, the porter heard three gunshots fired in rapid succession. Ali was found collapsed against the wall. "What have I done, my dear?" exclaimed Marguerite over and over. Marguerite's trial for murder began on the 10th of September 1923. The crime was punishable by death. Prince Edward was supposed to start a tour of English and Welsh cities, but his itinerary was quickly changed and he went to Canada. Her appointed lawyer was the famous Marshall Hall, known as the Great Defender. The jury consisted of young women who were noted to be barely 18. Her lawyer, of course, went all out to paint Ali as a brutal and sadistic tyrant with a depraved sexual appetite, and Marguerite as a virtuous woman who was subjected to physical and mental abuse. The judge refused to allow the prosecution to cross-examine Marguerite, nor were any details of her past life allowed to be mentioned to the jury. It took the jury less than an hour to find her not guilty of murder and not guilty of manslaughter. Marguerite was a free woman. What is unusual in this case is that Marguerite's lawyer implied that Ali's personal secretary, a Mr. Sahid Enani, had been having indecent relations with Ali, which at the time was illegal and shocking for an English court. Normally, if a prosecution witness is questioned, so then should the prosecution be able to question Marguerite about her background also, but the judge had not allowed it. Also, the way Ali was killed was described as execution style, but this seems to have been ignored by the judge and jury. What is also known is that Marguerite had a frequent visitor in jail before her trial. Major Ernest Bald had a close connection to Prince Edward. Ali's great-niece later said that one of her great-uncles had stated that Marguerite had given the prince's love letters to Archibald Clark Kerr, who was a British diplomat posted in Cairo, but who had travelled to London shortly before the trial. The day after Kerr arrived, Prince Edward interrupted his trip and arrived in London also. He only stayed for one day. After the trial, Marguerite returned to Paris. There, she fared better with the French press than she had with the English press. They treated the killing as a crime of passion. Her attempts to lay claim to Ali's entire fortune failed, as he had left no will. She even claimed she was pregnant with a child from Ali, a false claim which made her the laughingstock of Paris. Ali's family fought against her attempts to receive anything from the estate. But in 1937, a settlement was reached. Marguerite even enjoyed some limelight for the next few years, appearing in some minor French films. With age, she became more and more reclusive, and eventually drifted into obscurity. In her memoirs, she wrote that she was deadlier than the male, and it would appear she certainly had them at her beck and call throughout her life. Marguerite carried the title of princess for the rest of her life. She lived in a grand apartment in an affluent part of Paris, dying there in 1971, aged 80. Her grandson discovered she had been living on settlements from five different lovers. Well, my dear viewers, I hope you enjoyed that re-edit of the original silent version of Marguerite Alibert, the Bordello orphan. Yes, wasn't she a piece of work, Marguerite? One of my young viewers described her in the silent version. She left a comment and she described Marguerite as a boss woman. I thought that was delightful. Yeah, I think Marguerite most definitely was a boss woman. Yeah, I mean, you either loathe her or love her. There's probably no in-between, but I somehow find myself in-between. She was cold, ruthless, calculating, using people for her own benefit, but there's something about her fighting spirit which I find quite attractive. And Isn't it funny, though, that some people who are not physically stunning, and I don't think she was physically stunning, but there's something very alluring about her, even the way she looks. There's something in the eyes. I would have loved to have met her in person to try and get a sense of her sexual allure, and she must have been very, very magnetic in that department to captivate all those rich and influential men. Yeah, there are some people like that, of both sexes. They seem to be hypnotic in that area and give off a sort of, I don't know how to describe it, an energy or, a sexual magnetic field, we might call it. But a fascinating creature she was, no doubt. I just like the fact that she just kept bouncing back after every sort of defeat. Still appearing in French films, even after the French press and public had ridiculed her. I just find that sort of indomitable spirit quite amusing and quite captivating. So, did Marguerite kill Ali in the heat of the moment, a crime of passion, or did she execute him in cold blood? I will leave that for you, my dear viewers, to decide. Also in the silent version, a lot of people ask me what happened to her daughter. I do not know, but I do know for a fact that she went on to have a child of her own, which was the grandson mentioned in the story of Marguerite. So, but what happened in her life, I have no idea. If anybody knows out there, I would be grateful to know, and I'm sure the rest of the viewers would too. And also there were some comments about her name, Raymond, saying that it was a boy's name, but I did some research and there was also a girl's version of that name, and that was hers. So it was a girl she had, and her name was Raymond. If I have pronounced that wrong, apologies to my French viewers. By the way, my viewers, some of my subscribers, quite a few, have reported back to me that even though they are subscribed and have pressed the notification bell symbol, they are not getting notifications from YouTube, and never do, about my uploads or my announcements on my community tab. So I would just like to inform you now, I have left two important announcements on my community tab. I will leave a link to that in the description. I will also leave the link in my pinned comment in the comment section. Quite an important announcement. It affects my future uploads here on YouTube and what I will be doing next, some major changes due to YouTube's policies. I'm not going to say too much here for obvious reasons. YouTube might take exception to it and spoil your viewing pleasure with this video. So I will leave it at that and urge you to go and check it out. Plus you will see me, because I did promise after 200,000 subscribers, and yay, thank you. Thank you so much for that. It's not a million, but I'm very happy with it. It's certainly a milestone. I did promise to upload a photo of me when I was much younger with dreadlocks. Go and check that out. You might have a laugh. Anyway, my friends, not going to ramble on too much. I think you should go and check out the two announcements. Make sure you read both of them. And I hope you understand my reasons for my future plans. All right, the next video will be the collaboration with the lady YouTuber. By the way, I say lady YouTuber because I'm keeping her channel name secret at the moment until the video is finished, and then I will tell you what her YouTube channel name is, and I will also provide links to her channel so you can check out her great work. So I'm looking forward to doing that collaboration. As I say, that will be the next YouTube upload. And I'll talk to you then. Goodbye. God bless. Take care.